you know, this can work where if you really look at your people data and that really drives your people strategy, that can really drive your business strategy. So HR is in that shift there. You know, it's an interesting shift to make because people have to believe that this is the new HR. The same way that people had to believe that marketing is not a bunch of artists creating stuff. There are like analysts to measure so many things now. It takes some time for that shift like to happen.
Hi everyone, and welcome to a brand new episode of All About HR. My name is Nelly, I'm your host, and on today's episode, I'm speaking with Vic Akosile. Vic is a people analytics consultant. He also hosts his own podcast that's called Humanalytics, and I suggest you check it out if you don't know it yet. And he also is a very well-known member of our very own AIHR community. We are going to talk about people analytics, and interestingly enough, we haven't done so yet on the show. So I'm super excited to get started with that. But first of all, let me welcome Vic. Welcome to another episode of All About HR. Hey Vic, welcome on the show.
Hey there, thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, I mean, I'm very happy to have you. How are you?
Doing well, doing good. You know, I'm very busy these days, as you may expect folks inside of my space to be. But, you know, very exciting times though, I think, to be in this field.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I mean, that's also one of the reasons why we are going to have this conversation today, aren't we? Before we dive in, Victor, is there anything that you'd perhaps like to say to your audience about yourself?
Hey there, everyone out there who's listening. I'm Vic Akosile. I am based here in the Washington, D.C. area in the United States. I've been involved with HR tech, people analytics, HR strategy for close to about 15 years now, and a lot in different kinds of capacities, from small organizations to large ones, on the corporate side to consulting, on people, analytics teams, technology, strategy. So I've seen a lot, and it's been a really rewarding time and a rewarding career. So I'm happy to share anything that may be of value to folks here today.
Absolutely. I'm also very happy that you are willing to share about that, Vic, because as I said, this is a pretty funny, actually. We haven't done an episode yet about people analytics, and this is a really big part of the field of HR. Of course. But before we start talking about that, there's one other thing that I really want to ask you, because you do also talk a lot about developments in the HR tech field. So what development in HR tech are you currently most excited about?
Great question. You know, on the show, we do talk to a lot of HR tech startup founders, and I think that's something that I find really exciting. So I think I'll touch on two things. One is just there is just so much energy, investment, excitement into HR technologies. You know, I think coming out of the pandemic, you know, a lot of venture capital saw, wow, this is a area in business that hasn't had the same kind of digital transformation that, let's say, finance or marketing has had, right? There are a few big players, but there aren't a lot of big shakers. And I think that that's what's exciting to me, that there is a lot of energy and a lot of investment inside of HR tech startups, even up to this day, around shakers and movers who are open and ready to disrupt the norms of the big players. And I think that's because they can innovate a lot quicker and faster than, let's say, your standard, you know, let's call it HRIS system or something like that. So I think that's one. Another one that comes to mind is just really how much AI is driving a lot of the innovation. And I know for some people that may seem a little bit like, whoa, are the robots telling us what to do or who to hire? But I think it's more aligned with a lot of AI is assisting people to help make consistent, better decisions. That's how I like to put it, right? It's not that each search is perfect, but overall, you can consistently make a better decision than maybe doing it on your own because you have access to that data that's there. So I think those are, you know, two things around the HR tech space that really get me jazzed or really gets me energized to see. So I love it there. So I'll offer those two.
Thanks for that, Vic. And yeah, again, to our audience, you know, check out his podcast because you do speak to a lot of, founders, CEOs of HR tech startups. So yeah, if you want to hear more about that, do have a listen. But yeah, so today it's going to be about analytics, people analytics. And since this is the first time that we are going to be doing an episode on All About HR about this topic, I think first of all here, Victor, is let's talk about data-driven HR. And to you, you know, as an expert in this field, what does data-driven HR mean to you?
First of all, what took you so long to have a show on people analytics? I'm excited to, you know, be on it, right? Taking me back to my days in the AIHR Academy, which I will put a plug in for. Excellent Academy. If you're not in there, check it out. What are you waiting for? That won't be my only plug for that. But second of all, what does data-driven HR mean to me? And that's I think that's a really good question because I think it looks different at different places. You know, I've worked with companies large and small. Not all the big companies are doing your most predictive like analytics, and sometimes you see small companies do it. But I think how I would describe it is that finding ways, and I think this is it, it's the active, intentional ways to find ways to incorporate people-centric data into the decisions that you make, mostly a lot of times about your people. But I, you know, when it's done well, and when it's really put at the forefront, the people strategy based upon analytics is really driving your business strategy, you know, like a lot. And I think that is where, you know, you really can see data-driven HR really come to the forefront, right? So I think an example of that is overall people are having a struggle trying to find people to hire, qualified candidates and things like that, right? Well, let's say if you are a consulting company, right, and you bill out your talent, well, that is a direct impact to your bottom line if you don't have people, right? So how can you use data on maybe the labor market, graduation rates, right? Talent migration, internal like retention, to now drive the business strategy of this is where we're going to live, this is how we're going to hire, this is how we're going to look like in the next 2 or 3 years. That's really, really driving that business strategy. So I think that's how it looks in the, let's call it in the most advanced places. But to me, it even comes as something as simple as, do you have access to your basic HR data to drive like reports? And that may seem, you know, for some, that may seem really basic, but I've been in places where that's really hard. But even having something like that, I think encapsulates data-driven HR. So I think that shares a little bit of the spectrum about what that means to me.
It is a spectrum, and there's basically one side of it, and then of course there's the other side, and then there's everything in between. And for that, we do not have enough time in one episode to talk about it. I think we could probably launch an entire series to cover all of that. But now, as a consultant, I imagine you see so many different types of companies as well. I'm curious to know, what ways are you seeing forward-looking companies use data-driven HR?
A few things come to mind, and I'll share an example or two. One way that I think people are really using data-driven HR is really a combination of maybe statistics and analytics to help tackle or provide like drivers or levers for executives around the thorniest and trickiest of issues around DE&I, right? Like, that's a big area. So there is a body of work called organizational network analysis or social analytics, which is essentially trying to understand what are the networks that are formed within inside your company, right? Who knows who, right? If you were to draw a LinkedIn map of your organization and you were to look at it, you know, what does that look like, right? And for DE&I, we know a lot of research surfaces around that a lot of times the connections that you make, the people that you are able to connect to, has a direct influence on promotion rates, right? I talk with a lot of executives saying, I don't know what to do to help improve the DEI challenge. And I feel for them because let's say if you're a tech company and you hire people with computer science degrees, well, in America, at least, maybe I think the last time I saw it, only 5% of African Americans graduate with a computer science degree. So already before they even come to you, your talent pool is smaller, right? So you may not be able to impact the labor market, but you may be able to impact what happens when they come to you, and that's, are they progressing, right? So that's something that one organization that I know is doing, and they're looking at, well, is there a overlay or a correlation between the networks that are within our organization and the progression that people are experiencing? And when we take that and overlook that with DE&I data, are we seeing that there are disparate networks in our the diversity that may not be interacting with the right groups, with the right connections, with the right people that may be influencing promotion rates? Because now, as an executive, you have the ability to say, okay, well, I want to make sure that these people get connected with these other people to help foster that internal promotion. And this is a massive company, over 50,000 people, right? So they have enough people and data to make this happen. But to me, that's like super forward-looking, you know, of what those kinds of companies like are doing. So that's one end. But I think something that I think is really practical and that a lot of places like are doing is actually looking at their, like what I call your HR employee lifecycle data strategy, right? So when they come in, are you asking the same questions when they come in during engagement, doing performance check-ins as you're leaving to help to see, okay, well, where do we lose people in engagement or things like that? So that's something a lot of organizations can do, just kind of looking at that experience and implementing checkpoints or surveys to say, okay, are we checking these key performance indicators at each point of the employee life cycle to see maybe where like we're losing them? Because that can be a really good indicator for something that a lot of places are looking at, which is how do we retain more people? So I think that those are ways I see our forward-looking companies kind of use HR in a data-driven way.
It's very, very interesting that you mention that, Victor, because especially around the employee life cycle and the data collection around that, do you have the impression that that is something that has increased with the great resignation and a lot of people looking to change jobs or already resigning?
Yeah, I think so. I think I can think about two indicators. One is a macro indicator of the fact that investments in HR technology skyrocketed. If you look at like the difference between 2019 and 2020 and 2021, it is, you know, obviously those businesses who are in the space of HR data collection, people like analytics are doing well. That means companies are investing in that more, right? So I think that's one indicator. And I think too, colloquially, just, you know, from the conversations I'm having, I think that the pandemic exposed a lot of maybe inefficiencies in data or unpreparedness that the organization had, you know, and just inside of how they collect their data and what they know about their people. And I think another indicator is that in America, the Securities Exchange Commission, the SEC, put out guidelines that organizations have to report on their people data, right? So they have to put that in their corporate filings. Now, all of a sudden, you see this alignment, which is something that I love, with business outcomes and people outcomes that I think was not there, or that part of the story was at least missing. And now Wall Street and, you know, financial investors are now taking a very closer look to how are you treating your people? Are your people staying? Are your, you know, are people flourishing? Are they engaged? Are you diverse within their financial filings? So there is a incentive to try to improve those numbers before afford like to go out. So naturally there's some investment because of like the spotlight there. So I would say yes, like we are seeing some greater investments there.
Oh, wow. That is super interesting, by the way. I didn't know that. That's the first thing I hear about it. Is this something that's relatively recent? The fact that they now also have to basically publish these kinds of data?
That it's been official guidelines. They've been talking about it for quite some time, but I think last year was when they started to say, all right, we want to see something, right?
Nice. I mean, let's hope that this is going to have a huge positive impact then in the way companies treat their people, of course. Just coming back to data-driven companies and data-driven culture in organizations, and I'd like to touch on the leadership part in that for a bit. In your experience, what role should leadership play in creating a data-driven culture in HR and in the wider organization?
This is something I'm really passionate about, where, you know, leadership and most especially leadership expectations drives a lot of culture at a business, right? If your CEO wants to see something, everyone can change how they work to satisfy those needs. So for example, if your CEO is constantly asking, do we know how people feel about this? Or what does our people data say about this? Well, if you're a VP of HR or CHRO, you take that as cues of like, oh, I really need to get in line to be able to provide this insight that my leader is looking for. So that's, I mean, at the CEO level, but I mean, even at the VP and CHRO level, right? I think I'm seeing a lot of executives in those spaces come to their new roles to help revitalize and bring that data-centered, data-driven mindset to their role. So it's changing the expectation. And I think that's one thing that why a role that a leadership plays, because when you change the expectation, you start to change the conversation that people are having. Hey, you know, Jane, the CHRO, you know, wants to know, you know, how many people left between this time and why. Well, we don't know why. Oh, well, looks like we have to figure out why, right? So now that sparks the expectation, has sparked greater conversation of how can we do this better. And I can't speak enough about leadership's role in driving that expectation of we will look at data, we will base our decisions on data. And if it's not there, well, we have to be able to produce it. So a leader's role is, I think, vital in driving that data-driven culture, because they set like the norms, they set the expectations, they drive like the conversations, which ultimately comes down to what gets done, you know?
Now, when we look at the potential impact of people analytics on not just the HR function, but also the business as a whole, you mentioned it briefly already, but perhaps there's another example that you can share of a business problem that you've been working on with one of the companies that you have been consulting with and that you have successfully addressed. Is there anything that maybe comes to mind?
Yeah, I think that one common one, actually, especially coming out of the pandemic, that is very common now, it's this challenge of pay equity, okay? Pay equity, especially between women and men in the workforce. You know, the pandemic saw a lot of burden on women who left like the workforce to take care of families. And, you know, as we're either circling out of it, crossing fingers, right? Now, a lot of women are re-entering the workforce, and companies are taking a closer look at, hey, are we paying people fairly when it comes to gender? In those kinds of roles. So, you know, like what we do is that we, you know, we take a lot of their people data, compensation data. We try to normalize it based on role, based on tenure, you know, like based on all the things that we know that could impact somebody's compensation. And we have a look, you know, like we say, hey, you know, is this group of people within a certain, you know, level of expectation, let's call it that, of this other groups of people when it comes to compensation. Sometimes we see, okay, things are going well, but I think that when you really break it down to the specific roles and specific tenure, you can start to see some differences, and those differences start to spark questions of why, how come? Oh, this person, you know, came in at a much lower rate, even though maybe their male counterparts came in at a much higher rate with not that much different in job description. Could have been just this person negotiated higher and that was it, right? Well, let's try to fix that, because we know there are some inequities across the board, like when it comes to those kinds of things and those negotiation kinds of situations. But those are things that organizations are looking for at. An example that I point to that's actually pretty common now, and I think more consulting firms are offering almost a easier way to access that kind of service. And there's a lot of data and platforms now too that are offering that capability to really explore this issue of pay equity. So that's one I think it's a pretty common. And I think the only other one that comes to immediate mind is, I think, the challenge that everyone is trying to understand. Why are my people leaving, and what can I do to help to reduce attrition, increase attention, you know, or increase retention, whichever way like you want to cut it. And that's a big challenging problem, because there's so many factors that go into it that you really do have to scope that kind of problem down to say, okay, well can we look at a group of people or a cohort of population and say, well, do we have any clarity that we may be able to extrapolate from that? So those are, I think, examples of common business problems that we're seeing that people analytics can definitely address. So it's an exciting time to be in the field.
With regards to the second thing you mentioned, Victor, that's also where the whole employee life cycle analytics comes back into play again. If you know you're going to think about why are people leaving, so that's another one, or another reason actually why that is a super interesting part within the field of analytics, I think. Now, let's change tack a little bit, in the sense that I'd like to touch on building the people analytics function. Still curious to hear from you, Vic, what are some of the things that people get wrong when it comes to building a people analytics function?
A few things come to mind. I think one I touched upon kind of earlier, in that people analytics is a spectrum. Right, there is the spectrum of just being able to, you know, automate and generate reports quicker and easier. You know, there's that element of being able to have your business leaders self-service with dashboards and things like that. Right, so there is that element of people analytics, which some people don't like to count it as people like analytics, but it looks different as you mature within your function, within your organization. So I count it, because a lot of times it's the same team of people doing the same kind of work. So I think that's one. Two, I think what people tend to get wrong is that they think of people analytics as purely, you know, like the data science, you know, element and machine learning models and things like that. I mean, a lot of business problems can be solved by getting good organized data. I think that people may focus on the analysis a lot, but not focus enough on the data engineering side of it. How do you get data that's good, that's clean, that's accessible? And now is when you really start to do analysis. And that may, you know, like I understand if you're building a people analytics function, you're spending all this, you know, money on people, technology, and resources. You want to show, hey, this is the insight that this investment has made. So maybe the engineering piece feels like, well, you can't really see that. But it's something that if you want to really go far, that's the strong foundation that I would say is needed, is necessary. So I know the sexy machine learning models are cool, and that's what people want, like to do. But, you know, no one wants to be inside of a meeting where you're presenting and maybe you're showing a headcount number and the business executive says, well, that can't be right. No, I know I hired more people. Everything from that standpoint is questionable, you know? So it really is the solid foundation. So it's more about data quality, data engineering. I think like a lot of times then it is about the most advanced machine learning module that you can apply. So I think that's what sometimes people have a misconception about, that if I could change that, I would.
It sounds pretty obvious, but I can see how it's something that gets looked over, perhaps because it is so obvious. So yeah, that foundation is the basis from where it should all start. Makes sense, but it's really good that we actually emphasize the importance of that one, I think. So when we are talking about people analytics teams, Vic, what do you think are important skills and mindsets need it?
I think I may share a few skills and mindsets that maybe are not so common that I think are really important, and I think that allows people to really leverage their strengths and bring in different kinds of skills and expertise to the table. The first thing is the skill and mindset of storytelling, right? People need to be brought along. All right, you're doing all this analysis, you're crunching numbers, putting charts on the screen is not the end of the cycle here. Just because you have seen like the insight, you have to bring people along in the journey that you went through. Now, there are some times in some places where some people just want the answer. But in my experience, 9 times out of 10, if you give an answer of like, okay, well, why is this happening? Well, this is why. The next common question is, well, how do we know that? Now you're getting to the stir. All right, well, this is what we looked at. And this led to this. And I know from this department, they tend to do this kind of work. So this is what I looked at here too. Bring people along with that journey and being able to be a great storyteller, I think, super important skill. The next important skill that people may overlook that I think is important is to really be a good teacher, a good educator, right? In a lot of my roles, I find myself helping people understand what's important, what to look at, and why, right? And you're really, you know, you're teaching people really like the basics of analytics, but how to be, I think overall, how to be a smarter consumer of people data. And that's not something that is naturally occurring like for most people. So you do have to have a way about you or a skill set to be that coach, to be that teacher, to help them see things that they may not have seen before. And, you know, that's not an analytical skill. That's a people skill, you know, where people call soft skills, right? So I think, and I say those two first because I think it helps you to understand the role that different people can play on a team, right? Not everyone has to be the number cruncher, because at the end of the day, you have to share, communicate, teach, expose what you've done at your computer for, you know, hours with others. And if that doesn't come across well, the impact of your insights just get diminished. So I think those are two things that I think are important that I've seen, along with all of the other things that you would expect, you know, an analyst, maybe data like engineering and things like that. But I think a lot of people know that now. So I wanted to put some emphasis on these other things.
Yeah, and I think it's really important that you do so, because it's exactly as you put it. I mean, if you've done all this number crunching, you've got all the data lined up, but if then you're not able to explain what all this data that you found is about, then it's going to become a very difficult undertaking, I think, to get something done within the organization. So now, Vic, we get to one of my favorite parts of the episode, actually, and it's the part where I get to ask my guests, first of all, what they believe is the biggest cliche out there about HR.
The biggest cliche, and I think this cliche is rooted in some level of truth, is that I had one executive actually say this, that, you know, HR is a cost center and, you know, it should be handled as such. Sure, they can provide some value, but ultimately they're costing me money. And I came back to the executive and I said, well, you spend a lot of money on marketing, right? Is marketing a cost center? He said, well, you know, I don't know. I mean, they can help to drive sales. Oh, okay, cool. So who is driving those sales? Well, the sales department. Okay, who works? Well, you know, the employees work inside. Okay, cool. Now, what if your HR was not good and all your sales employees left? Now HR is losing me money. Ah, so if they can lose money, then they can make money, right? So that mindset of HR being a cost center is really cliche. And I say that going back to my first point of like data-driven HR, where data is in the forefront, can actually set a lot of your strategy, especially if your business is really heavily dependent on people, which according to the last that I've seen, 70% of businesses' expenditures comes from people. So for most businesses, you know, this can work where if you really look at your people data and that really drives your people strategy, that can really drive your business strategy. So, you know, and I think HR is in that shift there. You know, it's a interesting shift to make because people have to believe that this is the new HR, that, you know, the same way that people had to believe that, you know, marketing is not a bunch of artists creating stuff. There are like analysts to, you know, measure so many things now. It takes some time for that shift like to happen, but I think that's the shift that's happening. So that's my cliche. Don't know if that's a cliche answer, but I'm sticking to it.
Nice. I love that you're sticking to it. And no, that is definitely not a cliche answer, Vic. And I have to say, I find it a pretty tough one. So thanks for that. And then I have one other thing, or actually two. And this is when I ask our guests to share an epic win and an epic fail with us. And it's up to you to decide with which one you like to start.
Yes, an epic win or an epic fail. I have a lot more of one than the other. I'll have you guess which one that is. I think an epic win for me is, and this happens kind of sometimes, but, you know, going back to what I said around, you know, leadership matters and leadership expectations drive conversations. I've been very fortunate to see that where, you know, through working with an organization around retention, pay equity, having the CEO, having her really change the expectation that this is not a byproduct of something that, you know, we are going to look at people data at each of our key strategic meetings, and we're going to talk about it, and we're going to base our strategy using this kind of data, right? So, you know, like we were coping them with some pay equity and retention stuff, but I think what I liked about it was, because I had a privy of being inside a few of those meetings, is that the conversation truly did start to change, where other VPs and executives were reporting on their performance based upon the KPIs of their people, not just revenue, right? And I think that to me was like really, really rewarding to know the kind of organization they were, to seeing them now try to justify their, you know, their profits or losses based upon, you know, people data. But a really, really, I think, for a rewarding experience that I, you know, it may not be the biggest thing, but you can see and feel the impact that those things had on that organization.
Beautiful one. That's a beautiful one. Yeah.
So failures. Okay. Now, where do I start? I think, you know, something for me that was, I think something that was a failure early in my career was that, and I think I mentioned this earlier too, so maybe I was channeling myself, was that I didn't take a note or understanding of the maturity that the organization was in when it comes to people data. So, you know, I thought I was hot stuff and said, okay, well, I'm going to show you, you know, this and draw these correlations and, you know, show these models and tell you how much impact this thing is having on the other. For an organization that was, you know, super ecstatic when, if they could get their headcount correct, you know, and I think sometimes you can go too far and not bring the organization, and really I say the organization, but it's really the people there along. And because of that huge gap, it's hard for them to wrap their heads around it. So again, it's hard for them to believe it, right? Like, you're changing hearts and minds. That's essentially what like you're doing. And if you don't bring people along, it doesn't matter how fancy your analysis is. It's the gap is just too far for them to jump to say, well, I'm going to change my worldview on how I do work based on what this, you know, hotshot consultant just, you know, told us here. So I think that is a failure that I've learned. And this is why I said that the teaching part is really, really important. You have to be able to bring people along. So made that mistake quite a few times before I realized, you should probably change that. So, yeah.
Nice. It's a beautiful learning that you have there though, Victor. I mean, thank you very much for sharing as well. And I think that actually brings us as well to the end of our conversation, Vic. I mean, I really enjoyed it. I hope you did too.
Oh, this was lots and lots of fun. Thank you so much for having me.
You're very welcome. And thanks everybody for tuning in as well to today's episode. If you haven't done so yet, please don't forget to subscribe to our channel, hit the notification bell, and like this episode. Thank you very much for watching, and see you again soon. Bye.